Hi, Andrew Eubanks here, pastor at the Agape Family Worship Center. I just want to thank you for watching this sermon. It's been such a blessing to be able to do ministry through the various media outlets over the past few years. And we just want to thank you for your love and for your support. And we just thank God for you. But just before we get going with the message, we just want to lay before you a deep conviction that we have here at the Agape Family Worship Center that we really prayed about. And that's that this video sermon would really help to stir up your affections and your walking with Jesus and shape you and mold you into the image of Jesus Christ. But we also want it to be something that would be supplemental to your relationship with the Lord and in no way replace the church that you should be plugged into or the pastor that God has put over your life to shepherd and care for your soul. If you don't have a church home, we'd love to have you come and be a part of Agape. But please enjoy the next hour or so of this message, and we pray that God would use it to stir up your life and move in your life in a really profound way. God bless you.
Dear Lord, we give you thanks and praise for your word, for what you want to say to us this morning. And Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that you would speak to our hearts and lives, and that, Father God, that we would ever be impacted and changed by your word, and that you would have your way in us and through us, that you would get all the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Well, you know, the last few years have been very interesting. Over the last few years, one of the things that has happened and sort of taken our society by storm has been a lot of talk about eating healthy and making right choices and doing the right thing in terms of taking care of your body. So, you know, we've got all these commercials talking about the pesticides in your food and, you know, this and that and the hormones. And so we've as a society, started to look at the things that we put in our bodies and the things that we start to eat, you know. And so all of a sudden, we've got people who are cutting out fast food and saying, you know, it's just absolutely horrible for your body. You don't want to be eating that. The things that it does to your body is not good. You know, we've got people advocating, hey, you got to go straight organic. You just got to eat vegetables, you know, all kinds of stuff, right? And the reason for that is because we recognize the importance of taking care of ourselves. And this morning, we're going to take a quick commercial break to show you an actual commercial from Subway that was actually on TV a few years ago. So just look at the screen for a moment.
Start the year right. Eat smart with a delicious low-fat Subway Club on new, freshly baked, non-grain wheat bread. Subway, eat fresh.
If only it was that easy, right? Then you would know not. We would know better than to eat it, right? It's a much slower process than that. But anyway, you get my point. Is, you know, we've become so health conscious over the last few years. You know, gym memberships are at an all time high. You know, Instagram and Facebook and Twitter and Snapchat. You know, it's full of people taking pictures of themselves in the gym, showing everybody how awesome their workout is, and, you know, making people like me feel a little bit shame at the roundness of our bodies. But that's all right. But we've just seemed to become a lot more health conscious over the last few years than we've been in previous years. And the reason for that is because we've become very aware of the dangerous things that are in our foods and the things that we shouldn't be eating. You know, there's hardly a week that goes by that you don't hear about some product or some food having some kind of chemical or hormone in it that causes cancer or causes brain tumors or causes amnesia or whatever it ends up being. But, you know, it's never good, right? And we see all these things happening. And they harm our physical body. And so we begin to question and we begin to wonder, you know, is this stuff really good for me to eat? You know, it's interesting that a few years ago, back in the 1930s, somewhere from about the 1930s to the 1950s, that cigarettes were doctor approved. And yet, you can hardly turn on your TV today without seeing a commercial that tells you how bad cigarettes are for you. You know, there's always someone on TV talking about the effect that smoking has had on their life, you know, whether it's the loss of limbs or, you know, whatever it ends up being, even death. And up to a few years ago, We could see these, you would see these commercials and you would hear these things. And as a matter of fact, they even had doctors on the boxes holding cigarettes, you know, and the doctors basically approve smoking. And yet today we're outlawing it all over the place. You know, we're saying, you know, you can't smoke in restaurants and you can't do this and you can't do that. And we even have designated places where you're only allowed to smoke now because we recognize how bad it's become for your health. And there's a reason for all these things. And we spend a lot of time being concerned about our bodies. And the Bible even goes ahead and tells us that we should take care of our bodies. It even goes as far as to tell us that our body is the temple of the Lord, that that's where God dwells in us. And so, you know, the Bible does tell us we need to take care of ourselves. It tells us we need to take care of our bodies. It tells us we should be concerned about some of the things that we do, some of the things that we eat, and how it affects us. But it also speaks to us about more than just that. The Bible speaks to us about the importance of caring for our entire being. When I say that, what I mean is this. In Christianity, we believe that the human person is made up of three parts, the spirit, the soul, and the body. That's what we believe. We believe that within each person that there's a spirit, there's a soul, and there's a body. And the Bible speaks to us about taking care of each and every aspect of that. Each and every aspect of your life. Each and every aspect of your body. You see, the spirit is the thing that connects us with God. Just to give you sort of a quick summary of what we believe. The spirit is the thing that connects us to God. The soul is the essence of the human being. It's the essence of who we are as people. And then, you know, physical bodies, our body is the flesh, the thing that we're walking around, the thing that you see here in this room. And we can get a little bit more complicated than that, but that's sort of the basic essence of it, and we don't need to really go much further than that. And we think oftentimes a lot, or at least it's become a common trend today to think a lot and to be concerned a lot about the things that you consume and that you eat on a regular basis. And so, you know, there's a lot of people, you got high blood pressure, so guess what? You can't eat a lot of salt, which also means you can't eat a lot of red meat and you can't do a lot of things. So when you have certain ailments, you look at it and you say, well, I shouldn't do this and I shouldn't do that. I shouldn't eat this and I shouldn't eat that. Well, let me ask you a question this morning. How often do we stop to think about the things that we're feeding our spirit and our soul? How often do we stop to think about the things that are influencing our lives because of we're consuming them? And I want to talk to you today about something called food for the soul. Food for your soul. And you know, you might see the little monkeys in the picture, and you know, it's a little quirky. But how many of you are familiar with the phrase, see no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil? It's a very common phrase. It's something, as a matter of fact, you see the little monkeys there. The reason I chose to use the little monkeys is because if you go through your phone, you look on WhatsApp, and you look at your little emoticons, you know, you see these little monkeys. See no evil, speak no evil, hear no evil. And I want to talk to us over the next few weeks around this very similar topic and about this very similar phrase, even though we're not specifically going to be talking about speak no evil, hear no evil, but it'll be along those lines. And this morning, I want to talk to you about the things that you consume that influence your life, the things that you put, not that you eat to put into your body, but the things that you consume through the things that you watch, the things that you listen to, the things that you think that impact your spirit man and your soul. Because those things are important as well. Because the things that we allow to influence us have just as much of an effect on our lives as the things that we physically consume and eat. And it's important that we recognize that. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, we have an interesting passage of scripture here. And in it, the apostle Paul is writing to the church in Corinth, and he says to them, he says, therefore, whether you eat or whether you drink, whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. And that's the basic essence of what I want to talk to you about this morning. is that it doesn't matter what we're doing, it doesn't matter whether we're out in the street or whether we're in church or whether we're at home, whether we're eating, whether we're drinking, whether we're driving in the car, it doesn't matter where we are or what we're doing. As Christians, we believe that we're ambassadors of the kingdom of God. We believe that we have a responsibility to live up to God's standard that he's placed for our lives. And as ambassadors, just as an ambassador represents a nation, so too do we as Christians represent God and his standard, his holiness, his righteousness as well. We don't always do the best job at it. And we're all, the Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short and that we're going to mess up. But it does tell us that we must allow the Holy Spirit to work in and through our lives, and that we must let Christ transform us by his Holy Spirit. You see, the Bible tells us that even the most simple and basic of actions, such as eating food and drinking, something that every person does, something that we all do, is one of the most basic things of being a person. And yet the Bible says, take that opportunity to do it all for the glory of God. So how often do you stop to consider the things that influence your thoughts? How often do you stop to consider the things that influence the things that you do, your actions? How often do you stop to think about the things that influence your desires? You know, you can influence someone's desires. You can influence what someone wants in life. You can have an effect on that. You know, we usually oftentimes think about something that's sort of just deep-seated and rooted in us, and, you know, it's my desires, it's what I want, and nothing's going to change that, nothing's going to affect that, and to a certain extent, that is true. But, you know, I oftentimes find it interesting how, you know, you can go somewhere and somebody can like a certain car, let's say. Oh, I like that car. That's a nice car. You do? That's an ugly car. I don't think that car is nice at all. And then somebody else comes along and says, man, that's a nice car. And that person all of a sudden begins to think, well, maybe it is a nice car. And then somebody else comes up and says, you know, that's a nice car. And then all of a sudden, yeah, that is a nice car. I didn't used to like it before, but I don't know, all of a sudden I've started to like it. And we can influence what someone's desires are. And how do we do that? It's all influenced by the things that we watch, the things that we listen to, the things that we think about. These all have an effect on our entire being, not just our bodies, but it has an effect on our spirit, our soul, and our body. You know, there's some days where I wake up with a great frame of mind. I wake up, you know, positive and excited and ready to take on the day, and I'm full of energy, and I'm thrilled to go to work. I'm thrilled to get stuff done. And there's other days where I wake up in the morning, and I'm just kind of like, blah. You know, doing work, and it just feels like you're going through the motions, doing what you got to do, and you know these stuff got to get done, but you're doing it, and there's really no oomph in what you're doing. You're just kind of doing it because you know you got to get it done. And these are things that affect us on more than just a physical level. It affects the way we think. It affects the way that we feel. It affects the way that our actions for the day. And it has great power. You know, one of the things that I love is music. I just absolutely love music. Anybody in here love music? You know, I'm a big music fan. I really, really love listening to music. I love to sing as well. I'm not that great of a singer, but I do love to sing. And, you know, one of the things that I've kind of always done has been singing to my wife. And, you know, I've always sung to her even before we started dating. But here's the thing that I noticed before we got together, before we started dating, was that if I would ever sing to Emily, it always had an effect on the conversation that we were having. You know, she and I were, as friends before we got married, we would talk oftentimes on the phone or on Skype or FaceTime or whatever. And so, you know, we'd be talking. And my favorite genre of music outside of work, praise and worship music is R&B. I'm an R&B guy. I've always loved listening to love music. That's been me from day one. That's just my genre. And, you know, I would notice that whenever Emily and I would talk, if I would sing certain songs, it always would have make the conversation just seem lighter and make Emily seem more open. And you know, so I came up with a plan, and this is actually Emily's first time hearing this, I think. I don't think that she was ever aware that I did this. But I came up with a plan to always sing when or hum or something along those lines whenever I would talk to Emily. So I came up with a little playlist of songs. And so Emily and I would start talking, and all of a sudden, you know, I'd break out the Lion King song. Can you feel the love tonight? And Emily wouldn't pay me any mind. And she'd just keep talking to me. And she would ignore me, and you know, and I'd start singing the old classic, you are so beautiful to me. She knows this is true. And I would just sing it. And then, you know, I don't know what it was, but all of a sudden I noticed that the conversation started going a certain direction. And we started talking about what it would be like to have a relationship, what it would be like if we started dating. And the conversation just shifted. And it was interesting because I noticed that when I didn't sing, the conversation was always about the negative parts of that. You know, if we were dating, it was interesting because, you know, we would talk about, you know, if we were dating, you know, I don't know, you know, I don't know if I like you like that. I don't know how I feel, you know, this and that. And the conversation would always go that way. But then if I started singing some love songs, all of a sudden it changed the mood. You know, you're such a nice guy. You know, and you love the Lord, you know, and you're a Christian, and you know, and I think, you know, I think we would be good together. And it just changed the flow of the conversation. And so, you know, I would pull out some other ones and, you know, go back a little further. Start singing, the closer I get to you, the more you make me see whatever the words are. But, you know, I would do that. And guess what? It made a difference. It affected the way that she thought. It affected the way that she saw me. It affected the conversation. It even affected her desires to a certain extent. And it's because the things that we see, the things that we hear, the things that we think about influence our lives. You ever notice how you could be having a bad day, and the more you think about the bad things that happened to you that day, it only makes you feel worse? That's because it has an influence on you. That's because it affects you more than just your body. It affects you on a deeper level. And if we as people would recognize the power of these things, then guess what? It would change drastically the things that we watch, the things that we listen to, the things that we even think about. Because we would recognize how much of an impact and power it has in our lives. So what we see, what we hear, what we think can influence us, but it also has the ability to change us. It also has the ability to change us. Therefore, it's important to pay attention to all these things. So let's look at a scripture for a second. In Psalms 101, verse 3. This is David writing. And David says, I will set nothing wicked before my eyes. I'm not going to look at anything that's not good. As a matter of fact, there's another version of the Bible that says nothing worthless before my eyes. I'm not going to put things before me that I shouldn't be looking at. I'm not going to look at things that aren't going to benefit me or profit me. You see, because David recognized that the things that he saw would influence him. The things that he looked at would have an effect on his behaviors, would have an effect on the things that he did, the things that he saw, the things that he thought about. He recognized that he needed to, as much as possible, not look at certain things. And isn't it interesting that what got David in trouble was what he saw. He saw a woman bathing on her roof. And he looked and he saw Bathsheba taking a bath, and he looked out and he said, "Man, that looks good." And he sent his servants over to go and get her, and she came over, and all of a sudden, David ends up committing adultery, David ends up committing murder, all kinds of terrible things begin to happen, all because David saw something that he shouldn't have seen. And what does David say? I don't know whether this was before or after this happened. I really didn't check it, but it's interesting that he said it nonetheless. "I'm not going to let these things that shouldn't be before my eyes be placed before my eyes." So we need to pay attention to the things that we feed our soul, the things that we are consuming on a regular basis in our lives that are not good for us. You know, when we hear negative things, it weighs us down. You know, maybe if you hear one bad thing for the day, it doesn't do you so bad. But if consistently throughout the day, all people have said to you all day is negative things, then guess what? It's going to influence how you feel that day. You know, I've had days where I wake up in the morning and I'm feeling fantastic. And I'm like, "Man, today is going to be a great day." And all of a sudden, you know, I call somebody, or I run into somebody, or, you know, I'm speaking to somebody else, and all of a sudden, you know, all they have to tell me is negative things. And you know what? That's fine, but it does something to me. It may not make my day completely dreadful, but it's no longer quite as crisp and fun and clear as it was before, because now guess what? I'm thinking about the problem that somebody else is facing. I'm praying. I'm going, "God, you know, what's happening? How can I help this person? How can I pray for this person? God, what do you want me to do?" And all of a sudden, my mind becomes consumed with thoughts of, and it's not that they're bad. It's not that that's bad at all, but it has an influence nonetheless on how I'm feeling. It has an influence on what I'm thinking. You see, when we hear the negative things in life, it oftentimes brings us down a bit. And when we hear positive things, it brings us up. Just when we came back from vacation, we had a little bit of duty that we needed to pay for the stuff that we were bringing in. And so I went and I was paying for the duty. And as I was paying for it, the lady asked me for my phone number. And so I just simply looked at her and I said to her, I said, "You gonna call me later or what? Because I'm married, you know." And she started to laugh. And she said to me, "Thank you so much for that." She said, "You don't know how you just made my day for me." And now I really only did it as a joke, but I could literally see the difference in her face after I made her smile. And I was like, "Wow, God, thank you for that." You know, it made me feel good. I mean, I didn't feel so good that I had to pay some money, but I felt good that I made somebody smile. And I was like, "Thank you, Lord." Never take your wife shopping. Just kidding. But look at this for a second. He said, "I'll set nothing wicked before my eyes." And I just want to kind of talk about that just very briefly, because it's a word that I think we understand, but I want to just add a little bit of explanation to it. We've got this word wicked, but it also has the implication of the word worthless, but it also has the implication of the word unprofitable, and it also has the implication of things that will bring you down or bring you destruction. That's what it means. So when he says this, he says, "I'm going to put nothing before me that's going to be destructive to my life, to my family, to the people that I, to my kingdom." This is David. And it's the same thing with us. When we read the scripture, our mind should go and say, you know what, God, I don't want to have things in my life that are going to be destructive to my family. I don't want to have things in my life that are going to be destructive to my job or destructive to my church or destructive to my community or destructive to all these various aspects of life. We don't want those things in us. As a matter of fact, you know, we have to be very careful, and I'm not preaching against TV or music or any of those kinds of things this morning. I'm simply saying we've got to be careful what we watch on TV. We've got to be careful of what we listen to on the radio. We've got to be careful of the things, that the websites that we visit. We've got to be careful of all of these things because they have an influence on our lives. Even the books that we read. Even something as simple as books. We've got to be careful. You know, I want to share something interesting with you because of what an epidemic it has become in our society over the last few years, particularly because of the accessibility of the internet. But porn has become such a big thing in our society. Men, it used to be something that, you know, it was all about the guys, but men and women today dabble in it and do more than just dabble in it. And it has become a big thing, but here's one of the things that is interesting about porn is that porn, when someone watches pornography, it releases the same chemicals in your brain that cocaine does. And that's why we have people today that are addicted to watching pornography, because when they watch it and they see those things, they get the same feeling that someone who's doing cocaine gets. Those same chemicals are released in your brain that gives you those same feel-good feelings. As a matter of fact, there are people who today now begin to call pornography the new drug. Because we have so many people that are addicted to it, that can't break free from it. And why is that? It's because of the things that we see, the things that we hear, and the things that we feel, our desires that get stirred up when we watch it. And here's the thing, is that it doesn't just do that. There have been studies that have shown that people who watch pornography actually have changes that take place in their brain. Their brain actually, sort of, the makeup of their brain actually changes the more that they watch it. And then, it also begins to affect the way that people behave. Now, you know, we could talk more about this, but this is just one example that I'm giving you as to how we have to be careful of the things that we watch. The things that we listen to, because it influences us. You know, again, going back to, me and Emily with singing. You know, I recognized that there were times where I would sing certain songs, and after the conversation was over, that I would feel depressed. I would sing certain songs, and, you know, I remember there was one song, one of the lines in the song was talking about, you know, if I could be your man. And I remember hanging up that call and thinking to myself, man, I wish I could be her man. Why can't I be her man? And I sat there and I thought for a long time about, you know, why can't we be together? And I went and I prayed and I said, Lord, she's such a wonderful girl. Why? Why can't I have her, Lord? Sound like a whining child. But the point I'm making is the reason why I felt that way was because of what I was listening to. Because what I was listening to affected me in a negative way. So we've got to be careful of those things. When we get to another scripture, Romans chapter 10, verse 17. This is a powerful scripture because in it tells us, it says, so faith comes by hearing, say hearing, and hearing comes from the word of God, or hearing by the word of God. So what it's saying is this, is that we receive faith by what? By what we listen to. By what's spoken into our lives. By the things that we hear. We gain faith. But how many of us know that the opposite is also true? that faith can be taken away, or fear can be added, or worry can be added, or anxiety can be added, or doubt can be added based on the things that you hear. It's not just faith that comes by hearing. It's all kinds of things that come by hearing. But notice what the scripture says is that faith comes not simply just by hearing, but by hearing what? The word of God. That our faith is built when we are listening to the word of God. So guess what we're doing right now is I'm building your faith because you're hearing the word of God being preached. Your faith is being built. Let's just even take it a step further. What else do we receive from the things that we hear? Well, we receive knowledge. We receive wisdom. You know, what do we do when we go and we talk to somebody about a problem? You know, we're sitting down, we're saying, man, I'm having trouble at work, or I'm having trouble in this area of my life, or I'm having trouble in my marriage, or I'm having trouble with this relationship with one of my coworkers. And what do? We start to talk. And somebody that may be listening to us, hopefully somebody with wisdom, begins to share with us and give us some advice and begins to speak into our life and begins to say to us, hey, you know, why don't you, you know, pray about it? Or why don't you read your Bible? Or why don't you go and talk to this person about it in a non-confrontational manner? You know, don't go with a stink attitude, but, you know, go in and speak to them in love. And you go and you say that to that person, and all of a sudden that person walks away and they go and they take that advice. And how did they get it? They received wisdom through what? By hearing it. And they take that, and that wisdom does what? It affects their actions. It affects the things that they do. It influences them in ways to do things that maybe they would not have done it had they not heard it. Even when we take salvation, how can someone receive salvation if they don't hear it first? If we don't take the message of the gospel to people, how can people receive the gospel? You see, they're going to receive it by hearing it. But it's interesting that when we hear certain things, you know, somebody shares something with us, and all of a sudden, yeah, I had this happen. Somebody tells you something, and all of a sudden, your heart starts beating faster. Or your palms start getting sweaty. Or all of a sudden, you know, you start feeling hot. And your face gets flustered. And it's because you've heard something that has begun to affect you in a certain way. You see, what we hear will either build our faith and strengthen us and continue to impact us in a positive way or in a godly way or the way that God intends for us and our lives to go, or is going to point us in a different direction that we don't want to go. You see, we can't control what other people are going to say to us. We can't control what, if we're walking down the street, somebody might be doing in front of us. We can't control that. But what we can do is control whether or not we look at it. We can control whether or not we listen to it. I want to tell you something. Listening to gossip is just as bad as speaking it. Hear me. And hear me good, please. Listening to it is just as bad as speaking it. Because we got people that in Cayman, we say they like to catch news, CNN. And that's what they like to do. And we got some people that they got more information than the internet itself. And I mean, they know everybody's business. They'll sit in the room and they will be as quiet as a mouse. You don't even remember that they're there when you start spilling some of the secrets you start sharing. But guess what? When you listen to gossip, it affects your life. It impacts you. It influences you. It does something to you that you don't want to receive in your life. That's why, you know, there have been times where, and this, it doesn't happen very often, but I've had to do it before, where I'm in a conversation with somebody and they start talking about somebody and I say to them, listen, that's between you and them. If you would like to seek advice, that's one thing. But don't come and just talk about a person to me. Don't just come and just to share the news with me. If you have a situation with somebody that needs resolving and you're looking for advice to be able to resolve that issue, then come and talk to me. But don't just come and tell me somebody else's business, because I'm not about that. I don't need to know that. And you see, I mean, even then, we've got to be careful. Because we've got people who like to share, and we're actually going to talk more next week about the things that we say. So I don't want to spend too much time on this. But we've got people who like to come and they like to say, you know, brother so-and-so is going through a real hard time in his marriage right now. His wife is cheating on him, and the children have all left and gone, and the whole family has abandoned them. We just want to ask you all to pray for them. And they get up on Sunday morning in front of the whole church and say that. Let me ask you a question. What benefit will that have? I guarantee you, well-intentioned or ill-intentioned, people are going to leave here talking about it. And you want to know how many people are going to pray for that? Probably almost none. There would might be a few good old souls out there that say, man, I really need to pray for their family. But you got a lot of people that would leave and they would go, man, you heard about that? I heard she was over here last night. And then guess what? You don't even know whether that's true or not. And what are you doing? You're carrying that on. And the things that we hear, they influence our lives, and we've got to be so careful with what we listen to. You know, I love R&B music. I'm honest about that, but I've got to be careful with what I listen to. You know, I'm not one of these people that believes that all secular music is evil. I'm not. Are there a lot of things out there that is bad? Absolutely, 100%. I don't listen to the majority of it for that very reason. But there are a few songs that I listen to and I go, man, that's a nice song. The content of that song is good. The words are good. All those kinds of things. That's not every song, though. There's a lot of stuff that I have to look at and I have to say, whoa, whoa, whoa. Turn it off. Because that ain't good. That's why I spend the majority of my time listening to Christian music these days. But let me even tell you something where this is concerned. You got to be careful about the Christian music that you listen to. Because not all of that is good either. There are some songs that I have heard that I go, that ain't biblical. Where they got that from? I never read that in my Bible anywhere. So we've got to be careful on both ends of the spectrum what we listen to, because it can... both sides. Probably about a year or two ago, I was listening to the radio, and I don't remember exactly what I was listening to or what, but there was a song that came on that was talking about God, and I listened to it, and I was like, man, that's a really awesome song. So I went and I looked up the artist and I looked up the album, and then it started to play the first song on the album, and all of a sudden I hear F words start flying, and I go, oh, never mind. And I turned it off quick time. And I was like, how do you go from this to this in three songs? Don't make no sense to me. We've got to be careful with what we listen to. The things that we consume in our souls and our spirits, because it will impact us in ways that we can't even imagine. It will impact your spiritual walk with God. It may even have a profound and long-lasting impact on your family, on your job. It's why I spend the majority of time listening to Christian music. For that very reason. I spend the majority of my time reading my Bible when I read something, because I know, or some sort of Christian material, because I know what I'm getting. I read other stuff as well. But my point is that we've got to be careful. We've got to be so careful. Because these things will influence the way that you think. I don't know if I can recall this story perfectly, but I'll try. Heard a story of a preacher who was standing up on the street corner with his Bible, preaching the word just to whoever would hear. And he stood there preaching it, and you know, people would walk by and all kinds of stuff. But anyway, this one guy walks up to him and he says to him, "Can I have your Bible?" Preacher, being a little bit confused, homeless guy walks up to him and asks him for his Bible. So he says, "Well, what do you want it for?" He says, "Oh, the pages of your Bible are nice and thin, so I'd like to take them and use them to roll up tobacco so I can smoke them, or even, you know, some weed." And so the preacher looks at him a bit shocked. And he says, "You know, this guy's kind of brazen." Anyway, he says, "All right, here's what I'll do." He says, "I'll give you my Bible if before you roll a page and smoke it, you read it." So the guy looks at him and he says, "Okay, fair deal." So the guy gives him his brand new Bible. He says, "You know what, I guess I can get another one another day." Anyway, a few months go by, probably around 6 months or so. And one day he's standing up again, sharing the word of God on the same street corner. And this guy, well-dressed, walks up to him and says to him, "You don't recognize me, do you?" He says, "No, I've never seen you before in my life." He says, "I'm the guy that you gave your Bible to so that I could smoke it." So he says, "Oh." He says, "What happened to you?" He says, "Well, I smoked Matthew, I smoked Mark, I smoked Luke, but then John smoked me." When I read that, I said, "Good one." But it shows you the power and the influence of the things that we see, the things that we hear, the things that we think about. Because while we would look at it and go, "How could somebody ever allow their Bible to be smoked?" The things that he read on each of those pages before he smoked it was doing something in his life that he could not understand or comprehend. And so guess what? He didn't even finish the Gospels before it grabbed hold of his life. Don't tell me that what we see and hear and think about doesn't influence our life, because it does. It does, 100% of the way it does. And listen, I want you to understand something that goes even further. This isn't one of my points in my PowerPoint this morning, but if you're taking note, take note of this, that your thoughts influence your heart. They impact your heart. Let me read Proverbs 23, verse 7. Again, this isn't in the overhead projector, but I want to read it for you. It says, "For as he thinks in his heart, so is he." So your thoughts influence your heart. It influences your desires. It influences the things that you feel. So we've got to be careful about the things that we even think about, because those things will impact and influence us in ways that we probably can't even comprehend or understand. Again, since that wasn't in my notes, let me give that to you again. It's that your thoughts affect your heart. Proverbs 23, verse 7. Let's move on. 2 Corinthians 10. And in 2 Corinthians 10, we're going to read verse 3 to verse 5. It says, "We are human," and I'm reading from the New Living Translation, but it says, "We are human, but we do not wage war as humans do. We use God's mighty weapons, not worldly weapons, to knock down the strongholds of human reasoning and to destroy false arguments. We destroy every proud obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. Now, many of you are probably more familiar with the New King James Version, but this kind of just explains it just a little bit better that I think we would understand. We've got to be careful. What Paul is saying here is that we may be people, but we're not simply fighting a human battle. We're fighting a spiritual battle. And the things that we listen to influences us on a spiritual and on a level in our soul that it will impact. Remember what we said the spirit was? The spirit was the thing that does what? Connects us to God. Meaning what? The things that we hear will impact our relationship with God. But it will also do something else. It will impact the way that we feel. It will impact the way that we think about things. And so what he says is what? Is that we use God's weapons. We use the weapons of prayer and fasting and all the different things that the scriptures talk about. We use our spiritual weapons so that we can destroy strongholds. Whatever that stronghold may be. I want to tell you something. Just because you feel a certain way doesn't necessarily mean that the way that you feel is right. Because if we're honest, we've been in situations where we felt bad about something or we felt a certain way about something. And we felt like, I'm going to get in trouble for this. And we're hot and we're flustered and palms are sweaty and we're turning pink in the face. And then all of a sudden someone just says to us and goes, "No worry about it, we'll fix it." And you go, thank you. I was freaking out about that. It's okay? Yeah, it's all right. No problem. We got it resolved. We got it fixed. No big deal. You're feeling like it's the end of the world. This person just goes, no big deal. It's all right. And what Paul is saying here is that there are things that need to be destroyed in our lives. And so things that people say, the false arguments that people have, the false arguments that people have, the things that people tell you that sound true but aren't. You know, one of the things that many of you might remember, Dr. Davis, who was just here a few weeks ago, one of the things that I always found interesting about him, because he was my teacher in university, was that he liked to put true and false questions on our exams that sounded true but that were completely false. Absolutely. If you read that, you look at it and go, man, that's a true. That's not true. It looks true. And it seems if you just misread one word, one placement of a word, it seems like it's true, but it's not. We've got to be careful. This is why we've got to be choosy with what we listen to. We've got to have control or take control over the things that we listen to and that we allow to be put in our minds, to be put in our spirit, to be put in our soul. Here's the thing. Is that we have the perfect example of this in the human body. What goes in is what comes out. That's it. And so garbage goes in, guess what? Garbage is what comes out. Good stuff goes in, guess what comes out? Good stuff. And as people, we have to recognize that there may be times where there's going to be some things planted in your life. Guess what? We all got garbage. We've all got garbage in our life. I have to take mine out every Thursday night. Because the garbage man come for it on Friday. But guess what? I take it out. Why? Because I don't want my house to be full of junk. And so I take the garbage out of my house. I clean it up. We need to do the same thing in our walk with God. Because we need to allow God to clean up the things in our lives that are not going to be good for us, that are garbage for our lives. Those worthless, those wicked, those unprofitable, those destructive things in our lives that will do nothing for us. Listen, I've never seen somebody plant a mango and get a cassava. Never seen it happen. And if you have, that's some kind of magic. Because you don't plant mangoes to get cassavas. You get mangoes from mango seeds. We can't expect to put garbage in our life and get gold. We can't expect to listen to foolishness, to watch foolishness, to read foolishness, to talk foolishness, to think foolishness, and then expect that our lives are going to just be filled with wonderful and awesome things. It doesn't work that way. But there's a reason, and I'm getting ready to close here. I want to close with this scripture. There's a reason why the Bible tells us to pay attention to this. In 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 23, it tells us this. It says, "Now may the God of peace sanctify you completely. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless." Say that word with me, blameless, "at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." Now, as Paul is finishing this letter to the Thessalonians, here's what he's saying to them. He says, "Listen, I've said everything that I've said to you because I want you to be preserved." Or he uses the word sanctify, which is also the word holy, which is also the word that means to set apart, which is also the word that means to cleanse. It's also the word that means to purify, to consecrate. But it doesn't just mean to purify, it means to let the Holy Spirit purify you. And what Paul is saying here is this, is that God's ultimate purpose in your life is to make you holy. Remember what we started out saying? That whether you eat or whether you drink or whether you do whatever you do, we do it what? All for the glory of God. And it says in the whole purpose that God is talking to you, the reason why the Bible tells us not to put junk in front of our eyes, the reason why the Bible tells us don't listen to foolishness, the reason why the Bible tells us what it tells us to be wary of the things that we feed ourselves spiritually in our souls and in our bodies is because God wants to use us. He wants to sanctify us. He wants to make us holy. But he can't make us holy if all we keep eating is garbage. If all we keep seeing is garbage. If all we keep listening to is garbage. You see, it means that God wants to cleanse us. Can we let God do that? Can we submit ourselves to the will of God and just say, "God, I submit myself to you. I surrender to you. And God, I want you to purify my life today by your Holy Spirit." Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this word this morning. And Lord, I know it's a difficult word to hear. But Lord, I also thank you that God, just because it's difficult doesn't mean it's impossible. And that Lord, that even though we've all got those things in our lives, that Father God are the things that the garbage that needs to be taken out. I pray right now, Lord, in Jesus' name, that Lord, that you would purify our lives. That we would submit ourselves to you, God, and that you would work and move in us and through us. Purify our hearts today, Lord. Let us be as gold and precious silver today. Purify our hearts, Lord. Refine us, Lord, by your Holy Spirit this morning. That as we trust in you, as we put our hope in you, that you would move in a mighty way. I give you thanks and praise this morning.
Thank you for watching our television program, and we pray that you've been blessed by today's message. I'm Pastor Andrew Ebanks, and I'd like to take this opportunity to pray with you today and ask you a question. Do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Because if you don't, I want you to pray with me this prayer and accept him into your heart today. and you too can be a child of God. Let's pray this prayer. God, I repent of my sin. I'm sorry for all the wrong that I've done. And I ask you to come into my life today. Cleanse me and make me whole. I'm sorry, and I ask you to lead me down the path of righteousness for your name's sake. I want to be your child, and I want to do your will. Have your way in me today, Lord, and I will forevermore live for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. That's all you had to do, folks. It's as simple as that. And so if you pray that prayer today, you're a child of God. And so I want to get you plugged into a church. Get plugged into a body, a fellowship of Christ somewhere. And get deeper into your relationship with God. Because there's no greater relationship than a relationship with Jesus Christ. God bless you and have a wonderful day with Jesus.